So we're here with Dr. Caleb McMahan, who's the collection manager of fishes here at the Field Museum, and today we're going to be talking about clearing and staining. What is clearing and staining?
So clearing and staining is a process where we take an entire specimen and we clear that specimen down and use different stains to stain different parts of the skeleton.
So how is that process actually done? How do you get from something that's like pickled in a jar like this to something that you can literally see through?
In general, the process is that we start with a specimen. So here we have a species of cichlid from Nicaragua and Costa Rica. And so we take this cichlid, and the first thing we do, and again, some people do things differently, but I a lot of times take the eyes out. If it's a really thick fish, we might take the skin and scales off of it. And then we're gonna take out the guts. We take the gonads out and we store those in a vial back in the jar so that if later someone says, I have the skeleton, but I wanna see what sections of the reproductive tract look like.
Oh.
They can still go back and do that. So then we're left with our fish, and we first dehydrate them in really strong ethanol, like 95% ethanol. And then we start the process. And in general, the two big phases, one, we're gonna stain them. Mm-hmm. So we're gonna take the fish and we're gonna use a stain called Alcyon Blue. And we're going to put the fish in this solution, and it's gonna stain the cartilage blue. And then we're going to then use a red dye called alicerin red. Things with calcium phosphate will be stained red by this dye. The clearing of it, to clear away the tissue, we use trypsin, which mm-hmm. is an enzyme that digests proteins. It's found commonly in vertebrate digestive tracts. And trypsin eats away at the tissue, the proteins, but it leaves the collagen. So you can see I can still pick this fish up.
Oh.
So it's still an actual specimen.
It's like a jelly specimen.
Right, right. It's still an actual fish specimen. There's not just a pile of bones in the tray. And then we store it in glycerin. So this
gooey kind of stuff here is
glycerin. What's really neat about storing it in glycerin is that glycerin and collagen have the same refractive index, so how light passes through. So when you put this on a tray, on a light box like this, you just get the skeleton to visualize it.
So that's how we'll get invisibility cloak technology.
Probably coming from cleared and stained fish.
Yeah,
that's my
that
guess.
Will inspire how we develop that. Why would you use this process over just something like, you know, creating an X-ray or a CT scan? It seems like it would be a little bit more involved than that.
We still use x-rays a lot, radiographs for looking at skeletons. But the nice thing about cleared and stained specimens is that we have a 3D visualization of the skeleton, so x-rays don't give us that. Sometimes the location of certain cartilages or how they vary across different species or groups of species can tell you a lot about their evolution, their development, anatomy. And in fishes, a lot of times the larvae look nothing like the adults, and so you can track how certain bones change through development and how the general morphology of the fish changes, and those make really interesting studies.
So you can try to essentially track the growth of an animal or a species throughout different stages.
Right.
Are fish the only thing that you clear and stain?
They're not the only thing. So these are fish examples, but we also have a lot of examples from other vertebrate groups as well. These are amphibians and reptiles.
Mm-hmm.
So here we have a snake. You can very nicely see the vertebral column wrapped up here. There's a frog, and the turtles are interesting because they look about the same size, but you can see the blue one that's a cartilaginous skeleton, and so you've got an embryonic turtle there.
So there's a baby turtle.
It's a baby turtle.
Aww.
And then you have this smaller turtle, the small turtle here with the red skeleton that's...
It's just a smaller, a small species of turtle, but it's an adult.
Right.
So what are some of the discoveries or novel concepts that have been learned from using this process?
In my own research, I've used cleared and stained specimens to look at their teeth and the morphology of their jaws and how they look the same or different between species or across groups of fishes.
So kind of how something could move in relation to another thing?
Or in their appearance, but that's another really, really interesting way that people are using cleared and stained specimens for biomechanics and understanding. I mean, even here we have this incredible diversity of morphology in fishes, and this particular species has this very long, it's called an ascending process, off of this upper jawbone.
It's like a big extra bone up its forehead.
Right, and so what this fish does is you can see with the mouth closed, But to open the mouth, you can use this specimen and you can see how the jaw opens.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So using cleared and stained specimens allows us to look at how these things move and how these things feed.
So does this process destroy the specimen at all? Because it obviously it looks like it's kind of invasive.
It doesn't destroy it. It changes the form of the specimen. Instead of looking like this or like this, it's now a different appearance, and you can answer different questions with it. A lot of times, I think, you know, we associate to tell different species apart or groups of or fishes. It's not all just always based on external anatomy or mm-hmm. morphology. So sometimes there are characteristics of their skeleton, which tell us what species it is. And so sometimes, for instance, this is one of the type specimens of a knife fish. And so we cleared it. This was cleared and stained as part of the description of this species to make sure that the skeleton and show how the skeleton was different from other species
it
was
wow.
related to.
So scientists don't see this process as destructive at all. They see it as
right.
an informative
yes,
type thing.
Absolutely.
Can you clear and stain a human? Like, can you clear and stain me when I die?
Take a lot of trips in.
It'd be very expensive.
Yeah,
a lot of glycerin.
A lot of glycerin.
But you could do it.
It did. It'd be expensive.
Okay. I think that's a good use of scientific funds. Probably not. It still has brains on it.